The Shape of Dread, A Sharon McCone Mystery by Marcia Muller, narrated by Laura Hicks. Chapter 1. San Quentin Prison stands on a windswept headland on San Francisco Bay. At first sight, it does not look like such a bad place. Its sandstone-colored walls and red roof are architecturally imposing. The cypress-fringed hill that abuts them and the row of sturdy palms along the shoreline lend the natural setting a certain charm. The waters of the bay are azure or green or steel gray, depending on the weather, dotted with sailboats and the sleek ferries that ply their way from Marin County's Larkspur Landing to San Francisco. Not such a bad place at all. But as you approach the prison's iron gates, down a narrow lane lined mostly with ramshackle houses, you hear the rumble of loudspeakers in the yard and the monotonous hum of the generators that keep the huge physical plant functioning. You see the guard tower and floodlights and warning signs and the weary hopelessness in the eyes of the people who trickle through the visitor's entrance. The wind feels colder. It carries the stench of stagnant water and an indefinable decay. Then you notice that elsewhere on the promontory, no healthy vegetation grows, as if even trees and shrubs are wary of venturing too near the grim edifice. You realize how far removed Point San Quentin is from the posh newness of Larkspur Landing, the million-dollar homes of nearby Tiburon and Belvedere, the majesty of the Redwoods and Mount Tamalpais. In spirit, this place shares more with Richmond, the city that lies across a graceless span of bridge to the northeast, a troubled community blighted by slums, populated largely by struggling blacks, from whose ranks many of those housed behind the prison walls have come. And on a darkly overcast winter morning, such as the one in late December when I first visited there, you are almost certain to remind yourself that this is a place of misery, where human beings are often sent to die. I'd left the city early that Thursday morning, hoping to be at the prison at 8:30, but traffic was slowed by an accident in one of the northbound lanes on the Golden Gate Bridge, and it was 9:15 when I presented my identification and signed the East Gate log. I passed through the metal detector at the security checkpoint, where an officer inspected the contents of my briefcase and shoulder bag. Then I sat down, as directed, on a bench in the visiting area. It was early enough that there were few people in the area, most of them I judged to be either attorneys or investigators like myself, there to confer with inmates in private. I waited for close to an hour before approval came down, even though my name had supposedly been added to the list of visitors authorized by the prisoner's attorney. The desk officer entered my tape recorder in his log of recording and photographic equipment, and then I was led to one of the segregated visiting rooms for inmates of the Adjustment Center and Death Row. After the guard locked me in, I looked around the room for a moment. It was institutional tan, divided down the center by a wall-to-wall table. A heavy grill extended from the table to the ceiling. Had I possessed tendencies to claustrophobia, my surroundings would probably have prompted me to pound on the door and demand to be let out. As it was, I felt curiously suspended, as if time had stopped and wasn't going to start up again until some distant and unknown power said it could. Finally, I crossed to the table, set my briefcase on it, and sat in one of three wooden chairs. It was another 10 minutes before the door on the other side of the grill opened, and a young black man in blue prison work clothes was admitted. He was slender, of medium height, with a complexion the shade of cinnamon. In spite of his age, which I knew to be 20, his hairline was receding. The short black curls formed an M on his high forehead. Beneath it, his eyes were heavy-lidded and unreadable, his nose long and broad, his mouth set tight. When the door locked behind him, he glanced back at it and balled his fists reflexively.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.